Today on Spotlight, we have some stormy weather later down the horizon with some fair clouds today. No, I'm kidding. Hey, everybody, welcome back to another edition of Spotlight, and today I bring you Dodo Peak. And before I get started today, I do want to say thank you to Screenwave and Moving Pieces, I think the developer of this game, for giving me a code for this title. The game is actually just coming out today at the time of this video being uploaded. Wanted me to give it some love as it was being released, and I offered to do a versus video for it, you know, because I figured why not. I did the same for Eagle Island. If you recall, I made a review for that video about last year. Probably linked to the video on a card up top. They said, nah, Spotlight would be fine, because this is a pretty bite-sized game, and you can probably just tell by looking at it. So Dodo Peak puts you in control of a dodo, a species of bird long since extinct, and if this video game is anything to go by, ooh, I'm surprised I didn't die off sooner. So looking at the game, it's a very Q-Bert-esque design, where you're hopping down different levels of platforms, and your goal of the game is to collect the prerequisite amount of dodos, maybe your cousins, brothers, children, you're a terrible parent. You gotta collect them all, and then you have to get back to your home base without like getting hit by anything or making sure the babies don't get hit by anything too. At first I thought, this is like, it's like Sonic 3D Blast, where you're just collecting flickies and getting to the goal ring and trying not to get hit along the way because then you drop the dodos and all that. No, everything kills you in one hit in this game. It's pretty unforgiving. Like, if you get hit by anything, like, it could be rocks, snakes, crabs, yetis that throw snowballs, your dodo just dies. If anything hits the children, you lose a life, and it's back to start for you. That said, there are no lives in this game. Like, this is a game that you play on the shitter. This is a game that you play during a public transportation ride, or a game that you play in the highway when you're on your way to a relative's place. Well, I mean, and now, in today's climate, I don't want you going anywhere. But again, the shitter still applies. This is a very bite-sized game. Levels take no longer than, I want to say, 30 seconds. There are even achievements. Completion points for clearing the stage in under a certain amount of time. Sometimes, most of the time, it's like under 30 seconds. Sometimes it's under 25. Well, I think one of them was like under 15 because it's a very short level. But generally, it's just you as a dodo hopping up and down, moving in cardinal directions, trying to avoid everything that's in your way and collecting dodos. And just completing the level is usually enough to proceed along. However, you are rewarded stars for completing certain objectives. I mean, collecting all the dodos will guarantee at least one star. You can't help that. But completing it under a certain amount of time, sometimes you might find a ruby, and collecting that will not only give you coins, but it can also give you a star if one of the level objectives is to collect the ruby. The more stars you collect, not only lets you unlock more dodos, which have higher speeds for faster completion, getting a certain amount of stars, I think, is also mandatory for unlocking later levels in the stage. And this kind of threw me for a loop for a bit, because I thought just completing the stages would, like, unlock the other stage. And after a while, you'll get a prompt saying, you know, congratulations, you unlocked another world. It's like, okay, I guess I finished all the levels in this one world, and I'm moving on to the next one. No, because for, like, the first hour or so of this game, because I just have this really bad completionist mentality for these kind of games. Like, if you give me a game that gives you, like a ranking system, well, not so much a ranking system, but it gives you stars based on how much you do, I kind of see how much I can do in a lot of time. And if I screw up getting the star that requires you to beat the stage in like 30 seconds and I was like 1 second off, okay, I'm gonna try again. So for the most part, I was getting 3 stars in every stage up to a point, and it tells me I unlock the next world. I'm thinking, okay, I'm done with this world. But no, I did that as soon as like level 7. I think every world has 10 levels apiece. And by level 7 of a particular world, I would unlock world 2, and then I would just move on to the next world. So I'm going back to the level select screen. Or actually, I'm going to the dodo select, and I noticed that some dodos saying that you have to complete level 10, you have to complete level 20. It wasn't unlocked, despite the fact that, oh wait, I'm in world 2 or world 3. What does that mean? So I go back and it's like, oh, okay, it's not just a matter of completing the levels, it's how many stars you have. And I was collecting I was getting 3 stars in a lot of stages, so I was just straight up skipping levels and going on to the next world. And I thought that was very odd. Like, I thought level progression would, for the most part, just be like linear, just a matter of just you completing the stage. Like, the bare minimum, I thought, was just you completing the stage. But if you just do that, you'll probably get locked out. For your benefit, it's important that you collect as many stars as you can. If you can, like, I wouldn't stress out over the speedrun objectives, but the objectives that require you to grab all the coins or grab the ruby or defeat all enemies, it shouldn't take you that much time to complete those while collecting all the dodos at the same time. Because the level doesn't end until you collect all the dodos. That's just the name of the game. There are 6 worlds total, 10 levels apiece. Again, I didn't really get to experience all of them because I was just straight up skipping levels, the amount of stars I collected. Besides going through like certain climates, you know, there's a desert world, there's an ice level, there's a tropical level, there's the plains level again, but now there's teleportation pads. It generally dictates the kind of obstacles you're going to be dealing with. To me, I think the worst of it is probably the third world, the lava world, because you not only have to deal with these annoying as hell chameleons or lizards that like to bounce back and forth along their predetermined pathway, you also got lava plumes. And I should be more accurate, it's not so much of an issue until you start having dodos behind you. Like, once you start having your children behind you, you have to take that into consideration. Like, okay, I mean, your big dodo is gonna be fine. But it's easy to forget that you have someone behind you, and you have to keep that in mind as you're bypassing certain obstacles. It could be lava plumes in like the third world, and the first and sixth world it could be spikes protruding from the floor, or it could just be the different types of enemies. The lizards I already mentioned, the monkeys I think in world 1 or world 2, the crabs in world 4, which like do the opposite movements that you do. I thought they were random at first, but no, they just do the opposite movements of you. This game can get pretty tricky. Not overly hard, but tricky. You just have to plan your routes ahead of time for a good chunk of these stages. Although sometimes it's best to just bum rush your way through the things. Besides meeting the objective for getting like the shortest time, sometimes it's just the best solution. Grab some of these power-ups you see on the stage here. Like, I think there's only 2. There's the watermelon slice, which speeds you up for a time. Like, for like 2-3 seconds. It's not much. And there's also, I don't know what it is. I'm not sure if it's a beet or a pomegranate. I am unfamiliar with the diet of the dodos. So as far as I'm aware, like eating beets or pomegranate, whatever the hell it is, actually does make them grow 3 times as large, and that's why they went extinct. Their hearts couldn't adjust to the sudden increase of mass, and they died slow, painful deaths. It's a tragedy, but we have Dodo Peak to honor their memories. But you have to use those to just like bum rush through some of these stages and just like collect the dodos and get things out of the way as soon as possible, because sometimes speed is the best option. If you lollygag too long, you can get flustered and you got kids behind you. It's like, oh Christ, I'm gonna die because I didn't think about this. Although there is a technique you can do in this that I didn't notice at first, like for the first hour of the game, because I think it wasn't until like world 3 or 4 they tell you that you can do this. Maybe I just wasn't paying attention, where if you move back and forth in rapid succession, you can actually stack the dodos on top of you for like moving 1 square, which is not much. I kind of wish it was a way you could permanently keep them stacked on top of you, because that would make you know, the line a non-issue, but that would also probably break the game. For like 2 squares, you can move back and forth and you can have the dodos collapse on top of each other so that you're only taking up 2 squares at a time, which is great for compacting yourself when you have rolling boulders coming, you know, above you, or if there's not much room in, I believe world 5 or world 4 had the moving or sinking platforms. One particular level, they're all over the place. And the best way to keep your dodos in check is to do that stacking method. Had I known about that earlier in some worlds, I probably wouldn't have such a big issue. But that maneuver really helps you clear some stages when things are getting a little visually crazy. In fact, some things get a little crazy at points. I did notice some slowdown. Starting with the tropical world, you got all the foliage and the boulders falling, and the crabs. It did tank the frame rate a bit. The game mostly runs at 60 frames per second, but it went to like 30 around those areas. And sometimes it was just too much for some of the enemies. Remember this one crab in particular, just kind of lost his way. Or maybe he just, maybe he was late for the shift. He was drunk, he was hungover. I hit him with the power up, and I think normally enemies are just supposed to disappear. This crab wasn't having it. It's like, yeah, just leave me alone. Just go away. There were a few times the enemies got a little weird in terms of AI. Nothing that was overly frustrating, bearing one particular moment. I believe it was in the third world. I mean, go figure, that world gave me so much problems. The iguana enemy, again, likes to go back and forth on a set level, but I noticed one in particular, for some reason, whenever I approached the world from the left side, he would just hang on the side of the egg and not move at all. And it wasn't until I decided to break the egg from the opposite side that he just immediately moved and cheap shot at me. And I thought, okay, that's a little scuff. Probably want to look into that. There were a couple of other things that I ran into in terms of things that can probably be easily patched out at a later date. I remember, again, in World 3 is my personal hell. I mean, it looks like hell, and it's also just where I ran into the most shit. There was a time where I just jumped on top of a level, and something just fucking killed me out of nowhere. Like, I don't know. The bird probably had a heart attack, and maybe dodos are prone to do that. I don't know. They're long gone. But I just step up, and I just die for no fucking reason. And, yeah, that's something that definitely happened. Glitches are to be expected. I guess the question is like, you know, how severe does it impact gameplay? And I want to say it didn't impact much. No, I would say my biggest complaint with Dodo Peak from my personal experience, I throw this out as like a warning right now. If you're thinking of playing this game, I would approach this with the Joy-Con and not necessarily with the Pro Controller, because the D-pad on the Joy-Con are, the buttons are separated. You know, you don't have a joint D-pad. I was playing this game with the Pro Controller, and things are going swell up until I get to like World 2 or World 3, where I noticed that sometimes the Dodo would do double inputs when I'm like holding the D-pad down, because the game encourages you, like, to, you know, if you want to like move in rapid succession, hold the D-pad down and the bird will just make continuous jumps. But sometimes there will be a little delay on your next input and the bird will just keep moving in one direction even if you're holding it in a completely different direction. And I noticed it happened the most with the D-pad, because I did try it out with Joy-Cons and I didn't have this issue as much, where sometimes the Dodo will just continuously move despite you holding it in a different direction. And sometimes this only happened a few times, where I'm moving left and right, and the bird would just stop. Like, he would just stall for no fucking reason. And I did not understand why that was happening. That can drive you nuts, particularly for me, because, you know, I'm a big stickler for control. If your control is wonky, if your control is not up there all the way, I'm fuming. And there was, I want to say, 2 or 3 times where I started to fume, because I'm pressing these buttons, and the bird just ain't doing what I'm wanting to do. It got to a point where I was able to actually get in contact with the folks behind the scenes, saying that, hey, just a heads up, I'm playing this game and having a bit of controller issues with the Pro Controller specifically, and I just wanted to let you guys know that as this game is getting ready to go out. And they got back to me and they said that they now have a patch ready to go for when this game comes out, so hopefully this is not an issue at all. But I did want to give you a heads up in case the patch like doesn't go live like the day this game comes out. If you're going to play this game at all, you should use a Joy-Con. I would say that was the biggest problem I had. But I know, 6 worlds, 10 levels apiece, took me about 2 hours to pretty much explore everything. Although by the halfway point of the 6th world, I was like, you know, I felt like, oh, you know, I think I've seen everything the game has to offer. I didn't get bored. You know, these kind of games that are bite-sized, you're generally not recommended to, like, marathon them. Like, don't play for, like, 1 hour or 2 hours straight. Maybe do a couple of levels. Maybe finish a world in a session. And then come back later when you gotta take another shit. And finish another world. Like, go for 3 stars and all that. But, you know, the name of the game is, you're a dodo. Go save your children. Don't die. You know, shout outs to the cowboy and funk dodo. Those ended up being my favorites. There are some dodos that are not only locked behind levels, but there are also weekly challenges. You basically just complete them for the weekend. After a certain amount of them, you can just unlock these special dodos. I'm gonna assume that they're like the ultimate dodo special abilities. Maybe they're just really fast, because I think all the dodos, besides like looking different, are different just in terms of how fast they are. But it also means you're probably harder to control, because I mean, you hop pretty fast at times. I remember a couple levels in level 6, so I was essentially a coke addict, how much I was hopping all over the place. But if you like Q-Bert, but you want dodos instead of Q-Bert, I think Dodo Pig might satiate your taste buds. I think the game, let me check here actually. Yeah, okay, yeah, the game will be on sale for $9.99 when it releases today. For $10, nice little game to help pass the time. Yeah, I recommend it. You know, I can see kids actually playing this a whole bunch. Maybe the colorful aesthetic, the dead-eyed stare of the dodos, because their future is inevitable, might find visually appealing. I was a little nervous, like, I'm getting to the character selection. I'm thinking one of these dodos is going to do, like, a Fortnite dance or some other shit. Maybe, like, a little too cynical for that one, but it's like, nah, it's just there's a lot of colorful birds. One's a firefighter. Anyway, that's where I'm going to call it a wrap here for this spotlight. I want to thank you all for tuning in. I know some of you were saying, God damn it, another spotlight? Where is the versus content? That's what I subscribe for, damn it. I don't know why I went Vince McMahon there for a second. And all I can say is, okay, you're right to feel that way. I understand that a lot of you are subbed for the versus videos, like the full out reviews. And not necessarily these videos where I talk about games. I normally wouldn't have the time to dedicate a review for. But I did want to like reestablish Spotlight as a thing that I want to consistently upload for this channel. Not to this extent. Like, I think we got like 4 Spotlights in a row. And while that, I mean, that's good, just keep the channel relevant. Or just to keep the channel flowing with content. I understand that Spotlights may not be everyone's cup of tea. But for those that have been tuning in, giving the videos a comment, giving the videos a like and all that, I appreciate you tuning in. And thank you for the feedback as well. I've actually gotten some pretty positive feedback with the new format of Spotlights. And again, for like the indie scene in particular, I think this is like the best way to go from here on out, because if it helps bring attention to certain games, obviously that's a great thing. For good or bad. I don't know, because they're probably not going to be all winners. But it does give me the excuse to keep trying out new things while I'm managing working on bigger videos. That said, this will be the last Spotlight for a while. I'm going to get ready to help fund the charity rooms, Subpar Smash Brothers. That is beginning tomorrow, August 1st to August 9th. If you haven't already, please check out the main channel for the schedule, all the info you need for the event itself. Raising money for the Diabetes Research Institute. It's going to be raffle prizes. It's going to be incentives. All to raise money for a good cause. You know, you guys know I'm always down for that kind of stuff. So we appreciate your time and company. As always, I will see you guys in the next video. Thank you all for watching. Stay safe. Wash your hands. Wear a mask if you decide to go outside. Have yourselves a fantastic night. And take care.